My name is Hester Baer. I'm an associate professor of Germanic Studies and Film Studies at the University of Maryland College Park. And this is the second lecture in the series, Feminisms in the Digital Age, Transnational Activism in Germany and Beyond. Before I begin, I would like to thank my co-organizers for this series, Christina Scharf, Carrie Smith-Pry, Maria Stehle, and Pinar Tuscu. And I would also like to thank my audience today, graduate students in the fall 2014 seminar, Transnational Theory and Criticism at the University of Maryland, co-taught with Ryan Long. Finally, I would like to express my gratitude to the Clara and Robert Vanbury Professorship and to the Maryland Institute of Technology and the Humanities for their support of this project. My lecture today is titled Redoing Feminism, Digital Activism, Body Politics, and Neoliberalism, and I welcome your comments and questions via Twitter, at PopFemActivism, hashtag DigiFemActivism. In May 2014, Twitter exploded with a new wave of posts under the hashtag YesAllWomen, a campaign drawing attention to the ubiquity of sexism, misogyny, and violence against women. Users posted individual stories of discrimination, harassment, and fear, underscoring the fact that, yes, all women are subject to sexual violence. German feminists contributed to the hashtag, yes, all women, with posts about sexual discrimination and violence that also included the hashtag Aufschrei, or outcry, creating a transnational digital connection between two locally grounded protest actions, with reference to the Twitter campaign documenting women's experiences of everyday sexism in Germany that created widespread public resonance there in 2013. For example, German feminist activist Anke Domscheit-Berg tweeted on May 25, 2014, quote, hashtag YesAllWomen, der globale hashtag Aufschrei, weil Erkenntnis der erste Schritt zu gesellschaftlicher Veränderung ist, end of quote. Yes, hashtag YesAllWomen, the global hashtag outcry, because awareness is the first step towards social change. Hashtag YesAllWomen and hashtag Aufschrei present useful starting points for my discussion of feminist activism in the digital age. Both campaigns demonstrate the interplay of individual stories and collective modalities enabled by digital platforms. Both also illustrate the crucial interrelationship between body politics experienced in local contexts and feminist actions whose efficacy relies on their translocal and transnational articulation. Approaches to understanding the changing shape of feminist activism in the era of digital media have emphasized the potential of digital platforms for shaping new modes of discourse about gender and sexism, broadly disseminating feminist ideas, connecting to new constituencies, and allowing creative modes of protest to emerge. As hashtag feminism demonstrates, it is clear that the increased use of digital media has altered, influenced, and shaped feminism in the 21st century by giving rise to different kinds of conversations, changed modes of communication, and new configurations of activism on and offline across the globe and not least in Germany. Less clear are the specific political investments of digital feminism, which has emerged in tandem with the global hegemony of neoliberalism or advanced free market capitalism. My talk today is divided into four parts. I begin with a brief discussion of neoliberalism and feminism, and I would also like to call your attention here to the first lecture in our series by Christina Scharf, already posted to our website, which provides an excellent overview of many of the issues I will be discussing in further detail here today. I then turn to three specific case studies through which I investigate the new feminist politics arising from the conjunction of digital platforms and activism today. My first case study describes the interface between street protests and online representations in actions by and debates over Slutwalk Berlin, Femen, and Muslima Pride. My second case study investigates the body politics of Peach's digital video, Free Pussy Riot. In the last part of my talk, I return to a discussion of the Twitter campaign's hashtag Aufschrei and hashtag YesAllWomen, before drawing some final conclusions about how digital feminisms are redoing feminist politics for a neoliberal age. Feminism and neoliberalism. In the context of neoliberalism, hegemonic discourses of choice, empowerment, freedom, self-esteem, personal responsibility, and individualism have conspired to make feminism seem second nature, and therefore also unnecessary for women, especially in the West, where structural inequalities are increasingly viewed as personal problems that can be resolved through individual achievement. Feminist critic Angela McRobbie has described the active undoing of feminism that has occurred in neoliberal societies, which disavow feminism as unnecessary while offering women, quote, a notional form of equality, concretized in education and employment, and through participation in consumer culture and civil society, in place of what a reinvented feminist politics might have to offer, end of quote. In her book, The Aftermath of Feminism, McRobbie argues that the undoing of feminism in neoliberalism is effected not least through post-feminist popular culture, and is compounded by the way that academic feminism has dismantled itself over the past several decades, for good theoretical reasons, in response to debates about essentialism, universalism, and representational claims, including the problematization of the category of woman and the status of the body, the concomitant removal of identity as a basis for politics, as well as questions about who is entitled to speak on behalf of whom. The undoing of feminism dovetails with other neoliberal tendencies, including the dismantling of downwardly redistributive social movements and collective politics in favor of upwardly redistributive policies that have resulted in widening inequality, and the naturalization of free market capitalism as a neutral and efficient force capable of spreading wealth and democracy. The notion of precarity has emerged as one way of making intelligible a central paradox of neoliberalism. It creates a situation of permanent insecurity that disproportionately affects minority groups. But at the same time, its emphasis on individualism, flexibilization, and mobility offer unprecedented opportunities for destabilizing normative roles and eroding traditional social formations in ways that appear empowering, not least to women and gender and sexual minorities. Theorists of precarity, therefore, emphasize both the endemic insecurity of the contemporary world and the way this instability gives rise to potential for change. In his essay, Precarious Sexualities, queer theorist Volker Wattersdorf argues that neoliberalism is characterized by an ambivalent relation to normative genders and sexualities, which have begun to falter, but not to disappear, and which are subject to a paradoxical and simultaneous flexibilization and strengthening, resulting in a pervasive sense of precarity. Wattersdorf describes how neoliberalism appears to open up spaces for non-normative gender identifications, sexual practices, and affective ties, but the institutional sex-gender system is still an imperative. Quote, through these changes, individuals find themselves exposed to contradictory social role requirements. Quite often, different normative ideas compete with one another. Women are now meant to work like men, but at the same time must always be able to be all woman if that is required. So in the division of labor, in the politics of the family, and in advertisement, traditional ideas of roles are still as dominant as ever. We are therefore still a long way from realizing a freely chosen and choosable neo-gender that would disrupt the hierarchical division into two genders. End of quote. The co-optation and undoing of feminism in neoliberalism helps to explain the relative absence of public engagement with feminism in Western societies in the 1990s and early 2000s. But an increasingly felt sense of precarity among women and minorities, especially in the wake of the 2008 financial crisis, describes one reason for the sharp rise in transnational feminist protest movements in recent years. In the case of Germany, feminism returned to the public agenda with a vengeance around 2006 in response to the so-called demography debates, which blamed women for the declining birth rate. Young feminists responded with a new wave of publications, protests, and interventions, many of them aimed at resignifying pop culture and reframing media representations of feminism. While pop feminism, as it became known, played a key role in bringing feminism back into public awareness in Germany, it has also been characterized at times by unexamined privilege, by a limited engagement with differences among women, and by a tendency to reify feminism as an individualistic enterprise, a mode of empowerment connected to personal freedom and choice. In this way, pop feminism resonates with both neoliberal discourses of self-fashioning and state-deployed conceptions of feminism as a modern democratic movement aligned with European values and thus incompatible, for example, with Islam, which is viewed as patriarchal and backwards. And I'll return to this point later on in the talk. While pop feminism has strong domestic roots in national debates about changing demographics and gender roles in Germany, its development since 2006 has been marked by engagement with transnational feminist protest movements, including the Ukrainian-based group Femin, founded in 2008, and its many global offshoots, which now count 150,000 active members worldwide. The Slutwalk protest action, which began in Canada in 2011 and subsequently took place in at least 75 cities across the globe, and the actions performed and inspired by the Russian art collective Pussy Riot, especially the solidarity movement that emerged after two members of the group were sentenced to serve time in a Siberian labor camp for their 2012 punk prayer protest. Crucially, pop feminism in Germany emerged in tandem with the rise of digital platforms, a dynamic blogosphere, active discussion boards, early adoption of Twitter, and extensive use of Tumblr helped to create a widespread public discussion of feminism. In a 2014 interview, activist Chris Coover, co-founder of the pop feminist publication Missy Magazine, describes the increasing significance of digital feminisms, noting that contemporary feminists use digital media above all, quote, to analyze how different events are connected to sexism. While digital platforms are well suited to serve this hermeneutic function, to what extent are they also effective in supporting the goals of feminist protest, broadly construed as techniques of overcoming inequality, promoting social change, or shaping knowledge production? Goals that are challenged in new ways by the neoliberal co-optation of collective politics. In response to the undoing of feminism in Western societies, I argue that the contemporary feminist protest actions considered here are in a sense redoing feminism for a neoliberal age. As I suggest, by working through, making visible, and re-signifying central tensions in contemporary feminism, as well as the precarity of feminism itself in neoliberalism, these protests have begun to re-establish the grounds for a collective feminist politics beyond the realm of the self-styled individual. Crucial to this redoing of feminism is the interplay between digital platforms, the transnational mediascape of the internet, a space encompassing and highlighting difference in which discussions play out in a disembodied and sometimes anonymous forum, and local protests that draw attention to the female body as a site of contention in the politics of gender, sexuality, race, religion, and culture today. So I come now to my first case study, Slutwalk, Femen, and Muslima Pride. Slutwalk originated in Toronto in 2011 after comments by a city policeman that women should, quote, avoid dressing like sluts in order to prevent sexual assault. Slutwalk actions worldwide have drawn attention to rape culture, slut shaming, victim blaming, and issues of consent. While organizers emphasize that slutwalks do not have a dress code, the marches became notorious for the way that some sex-positive feminists sought to reclaim the term slut by appropriating its associations in colorful performances featuring various states of undress. Building on the feminist aesthetics of the Riot Girl movement, Slutwalk re-signified the idea of expressing rage at patriarchal conditions with loud, angry public protest that turned both hegemonic femininity and received gender and sexual roles on their heads. In so doing, these protests resoundingly put feminism back on the political agenda in a way that foregrounded the precarious place of women's bodies in the public sphere, and especially their ongoing subjugation to sexual violence. As a large collective action mobilizing masses of bodies, Slutwalk aims to call attention to and stave off regimes of discipline and control to which women and sexual minorities are disproportionately subjected. At the same time, the significant transnational feminist debates regarding the tactics of Slutwalk and the ultimate dismantling of the movement that resulted in many places have literally played out, largely within digital spaces, the central tensions that underpin contemporary feminism, as the example of Slutwalk Berlin demonstrates. The first Slutwalk Berlin took place on August 13, 2011, with 3,500 participants. Due to growing criticisms of the Slutwalk movement worldwide, as well as specific objections articulated by women of color in Germany, Slutwalk Berlin organized a second march, held on September 15, 2012, with the supplementary title Demo gegen Sexismus, sexualisierte Gewalt und ihre Verharmlosung, Demonstration against Sexism, Sexualized Violence, and their Trivialization. Objections to Slutwalk in Germany and elsewhere have focused on the movement's failure to acknowledge the key role of white privilege in the ability to reclaim the term slut. Slutwalk's problematic normalization of dehumanizing language and symbols, and its exclusivity as a movement that appears to foreground the bodies of cisgendered, middle-class white women, offering little space within its corporeal politics or its performative aesthetics for people of color, LGBT people, economically disadvantaged groups, or sex workers. In the case of Slutwalk Berlin, the catalyst for the movement's voluntary dismantling was a particularly objectionable performance by Femen at the 2012 march. The Ukrainian group Femen was founded to protest the collusion of church and state in gender subordination in Ukraine, as well as the predominance of sex trafficking there, and it has gained extensive media coverage for calling attention to these issues through its topless tactics. Femen's global offshoots, especially those in Europe, have emphasized a critique of religion, especially Islam, which is viewed by Femen as a patriarchal institution that plays a key role in the oppression of women today, not least through veiling practices. The wearing of hijab stands in tension with Femen's so-called sextremism, which emphasizes female nudity as a strategy of liberation. At Slutwalk Berlin, members of Femen Germany staged an action in front of the Brandenburger Tor, in which they appeared in niqabs painted on their faces and naked chests, while holding placards proclaiming, "Kein Kleidungsstück rechtfertigt sexuelle Gewalt," no item of clothing justifies sexual violence, and "Unveil women's right to unveil." By literally performing in blackface, Femen not only engaged in racist behavior, but also trivialized the very specific criticisms of slutwalk already enunciated by people of color. On both accounts, they quite intentionally sought to speak on behalf of others and insisted on denying agency to Muslim women and women of color. Moreover, their action declared Muslim covering to be a coercive form of gender subjugation that they problematically equated with sexual violence. Femen has repeatedly staged actions that make such asymmetrical equations in ways that are designed to provoke. These tactics have been widely criticized by feminists, who have also suggested that Femen's sextremism reproduces hegemonic femininity with its foregrounding of nude female bodies that conform to heteronormative beauty ideals. In the aftermath of Slutwalk Berlin 2012, images of Femen's blackfacing action went viral on the internet, where an intense debate ensued in feminist blogs and discussion boards. This debate replayed many of the central tensions within historical and contemporary feminist discourse, notably those surrounding the category of woman, the role of the body, privilege, especially white privilege and racism, as well as epistemological problems surrounding feminist speech, including the place of experience and the problem of speaking on behalf of others. Vocal in the debate were feminists of color, who expressed objections not only to Femen, but also to the slutwalk organizers' inadequate response, in which they failed to acknowledge either the inherent racism of the black-facing action or Femen's denial of agency to Muslim women by speaking on their behalf. German-based people of color websites, including Der Schwarze Blog, the Black Blog, linked protest letters formulated by women of color transnationally in posts explaining the problem with slutwalks. In 2013, after failed attempts to reorganize under a different name, Slutwalk Berlin organizers responded to these criticisms with a decision to terminate the movement. The decision was announced in a May 13th post on Slutwalk Berlin's Facebook page, which ended with a statement, quote, "Wir lieben die Idee einer solidarischen Bewegung." We love the idea of a solidarity movement. Slutwalk Berlin failed to sustain a collective movement accommodating differences among women. But the debates about its universalizing tendencies represent a noteworthy example of the contentious redoing of feminism at the interface of embodied street protests and the sustained discussions enabled by digital platforms. Meanwhile, Femen has continued to stage similar actions, such as the disturbing Topless Jihad Day, a protest in solidarity with the Tunisian activist Amina Tyler. Tyler received death threats after posting photos of herself online in which she appeared with the words, quote, "I own my body, it's not the source of anyone's honor," written in Arabic across her bare chest. Tyler had joined Femen after seeing photos of its actions online. She has subsequently quit the group because of concerns about its Islamophobia. Like Tyler, Muslim women worldwide have been variously inspired and disturbed by the actions of Femen, Slutwalk, and others, and have spearheaded actions that both draw on and resist their tactics, actions that emphasize performances of veiling. For example, the group Muslima Pride staged an action at the same Berlin mosque that had been the site of Femen's protest on Topless Jihad Day. Wearing hijab and posing in the same spot as Femen, they carried placards proclaiming Gegen Unterdrückung, against oppression, and Islam is my choice. Images subsequently posted and disseminated widely via the organization's Facebook page. As Beverly Weber argues in her recent book on Islam and German culture, quote, "Muslim women as participants in public democracy are largely unthinkable in the public sphere," end of quote. To the extent that the headscarf is regarded in Europe as an emblem of Muslim women's oppression and entrapment in a regime of gender violence, Muslim covering is illegible as a complex embodied practice. In their anti-Femen protests, Muslima Pride not only make legible precisely this complexity, but they also assert themselves as participants in European democracy and the modern public sphere via their contributions to digital feminism. At the same time, Muslima Pride's adoption of discourses of freedom and choice in their defense of Islam and Muslim covering resonates with neoliberalism, underscoring the precarity of feminist protests today. By working through and making visible contentious feminist issues around the intersections of race, class, gender, sexuality, and religion, the interventions of digital feminist activists, including Muslima Pride, surrounding Slutwalk Berlin and Femen, trouble the unquestioned alignment of feminism with European values in order to assert feminism's status as a transnational force struggling to confront varieties of gender subordination today. Okay, so now I come to my second case study, the Free Pussy Riot video by Peaches. On August 8, 2012, the queer performance artist and electropop musician Peaches shot a video for her song Free Pussy Riot in Berlin. Hundreds of people responded to messages sent out via social networking sites to assemble in Prenzlauer Berg wearing Pussy Riot-inspired gear, including balaclavas in neon colors. The video depicts the group marching down Oderberger Straße into Mauer Park, interspersed with messages of solidarity submitted to Peaches and her video editor over the internet. Covered widely in the media worldwide, Peaches' video drew attention to the Pussy Riot trial. It also popularized the idea of dressing in solidarity with Pussy Riot. In the video, people of all shapes and sizes dance, hop, and gyrate en masse, shaking their fists above their heads. Statuses such as race and gender are largely obscured by the masks and uniforms, echoing Pussy Riot's symbolic obscuring of individualism in favor of an image of collective solidarity, and underscoring their refutation of hegemonic femininity. However, the video also includes ample footage of unmasked people. Many of these images foreground bodies through obscene gestures, displays of naked body parts, and close-ups of skin that has been inscribed with homages to Pussy Riot. We see pregnant bellies, bare breasts and asses, someone on a toilet, waggling tongues, and numerous vaginal references. Many of the unmasked individuals are also recognizable as rock stars and other celebrities lending their faces to the project. These aspects of the Peaches video stand in tension with Pussy Riot's own conceptual notion of creating characters who express ideas. Instead, the Peaches video reconnects the objective of starting a pussy riot to individual bodies. If the homage to Pussy Riot's aesthetic of masking exemplifies the transnational cultural dimension of Peach's feminist action, the foregrounding of stylized bodies creates a local connection to pop feminism in Berlin. As Carrie Smith Pry has argued, in pop feminism, quote, the feminist understanding that the body creates and displays meaning inscribed by a masculine-dominated system continues to be recognized, but also manipulated. Women's satisfaction with and control over their bodies and sexuality is paramount. End of quote. By emphasizing both of these qualities in its pastiche of signifiers, the Peaches video makes visible the precarious state of the female body in neoliberalism, at once the site on which hegemonic femininity is inscribed and a DIY space of self-stylization and sexual pleasure. The lyrics of Free Pussy Riot include the lines, quote, church and state separate, shoot a flare for the punk prayer, screw your old school Papa Greed, anarchist feminist what we need. By making the song and video available for free online, and by encouraging viewers to donate to Pussy Riot's legal defense fund in lieu of a purchase price, Peaches extends her activist message to a critique of the commodification of art in global capitalism. The video and the song ultimately create a riotous and pleasurable space for re-signifying feminism as a creative, collective movement against gender subordination. Hashtag Aufschrei and hashtag YesAllMoon. Aili Marie Tripp has noted the historical significance for transnational feminist protest movements of organizing around violence against women, which was a catalyst for global networking among second-wave feminists in the 1970s, and which, by the end of the 20th century, quote, had become the most important international women's issue and the most dynamic human rights concern globally, end of quote. The protests I have discussed today all connect to this historical trajectory. In the case of hashtag Aufschrei and hashtag YesAllWomen, the digital platform of Twitter is crucial to framing within translocal and transnational networks episodes of discrimination and violence experienced within specific local circumstances in order to make visible the pervasive structural inequality of women. The hashtag Aufschrei first emerged in January 2013 when thousands of German women broadcast personal stories of everyday sexism over Twitter. Organized by a group of feminist activists, the hashtag Aufschrei campaign responded to a series of national political events in Germany. Several male politicians running for election in a federal race made misogynist comments, and a female journalist reported being groped and harassed by one of these politicians while covering the election. Hashtag Aufschrei was the first social media campaign in Germany to achieve widespread public resonance, spilling over into conventional media, including print journalism and television talk shows, where many well-known public figures, including politicians, discussed the ubiquity of sexism in Germany today. In June 2013, hashtag Aufschrei even won a major media award, the Grimme Prize, which honored its influence in the German public sphere. Hashtag YesAllWomen also emerged in direct response to a local event in the United States, the horrific murder of six undergraduate students near the University of California Santa Barbara campus. Before embarking on this killing spree, and then shooting himself, 22-year-old Elliot Roger had posted a misogynist video on YouTube in which he expressed his intention to punish women for refusing to sleep with him. Within a few days of the killings, more than a million posts had used the hashtag YesAllWomen. Collectively, these posts underscored the ubiquity of misogyny today, calling attention to both the individual traumas caused by sexual harassment and rape and the larger structural dimensions of social inequality and male privilege underpinning violence against women. Many Twitter users responded to these campaigns with objections, for example, the hashtag NotAllMen, to which feminist activists replied with an exposition of basic tenets of feminist analysis framed within local, national, and transnational contexts. In this sense, these campaigns literally redo feminism in a public context, rehearsing long-standing debates about male privilege. But these campaigns don't just rehash old feminist ideas and debates. they actively renegotiate feminist politics for a neoliberal age. By emphasizing the way individual stories, when compiled under one hashtag, demonstrate collective experiences, they highlight the interplay of the individual and the collective. In a recent essay, Chandra Talpati Mohanty asks, quote, "What happens to the key feminist construct of the personal is political when the political, the collective public domain of politics, is reduced to the personal in neoliberalism?" End of quote. Despite significant qualitative differences in their tactics, the protests I have discussed today all discursively combat the neoliberal reduction of the political to the personal by making visible the universalizing tendencies of feminist tactics that occlude difference, by drawing attention to the relationship of personal experiences to structural inequalities, and by highlighting the ongoing precarity of individual female bodies in public spaces. In so doing, these digital feminisms lay the groundwork for reestablishing a collective feminist politics today. Thank you very much.